وَمَنْ أَحْسَنُ قَوْلًا مِّمَّنْ دَعَا إِلَى اللَّهِ وَعَمِلَ صَالِحًا وَقَالَ إِنَّنِي مِنَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. أما بعد, I welcome you to another episode of our regular series on Tuesday, which is our Q&A series. And today, inshallah ta'ala, the entire hour, inshallah, we will be discussing theological questions. I've been delaying these for quite a while. I've been concentrating on legal issues. But this week, inshallah ta'ala, we'll be doing two very important theological questions that have been asked a lot of times. And so we begin with our first question. Sister Samina from Wisconsin, she says that she has heard a lot about the Salafi and Ash'ari ideologies or theologies. And she's asking, can I explain the difference between these two theologies or ideologies? This question is actually a very common one. And anybody who is in any way, fashion or form linked with the da'wah scene or with the online debates and issues or even with Islamic scholarship, they're very well aware of these two strands within mainstream Sunnism. At the same time, those that are not involved with the online da'wah scene, those that are not involved with Islamic academics, they are blissfully, alhamdulillah, unaware, and these two names might not even be known to them. And so we have to really take a step back and understand that the religion of Islam, of course, since the very beginning of the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Muslim community has attempted to interpret various issues and controversies in different ways. We are all aware of the Sunni Shia divide, which again goes back to very, very early Islam. What a lot of people are vaguely aware of is that even within Ahl Sunnah or Sunnism, there are a number of interpretations or trends. And these two terms that are being asked about today, they apply to two different interpretations or two slightly different theologies within mainstream Sunnism. Now, of course, the term Sunni, I've talked about this in other lectures, the term Sunni comes from Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. This is a term that first was in vogue, we can say definitely within the first 50 years of the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Within the first 100 years, we actually have references of treatises and people talking about Ahl Sunnah. So it's a very early term. And the meaning of Ahl Sunnah or Sunni was the group of Muslims who, a number of things combined them. First and foremost, they viewed the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as being of paramount importance, second only to the Quran. So this group of Muslims followed the Quran and the Sunnah, hence they're called Sunni. Now, of course, there are other interpretations of Islam. The Shia community considers the need to have a living imam. And so the imam takes on what for the Sunnah does for the Sunnis, the imam does for the Shia community, that he interprets the law. And so they have a different notion. And of course, other groups have other interpretations of what they're going to follow. So the Sunni community wanted to follow the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, hence they're called Ahl Sunnah. Also, another thing that united all of them is the respect for the Sahaba. All of the Sahaba are considered to be worthy of respect, and the Sunni community does not say anything negative or bad about any Muslim who accompanied the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's another hallmark of Sunni Islam. Another hallmark of Sunni Islam is their belief in predestination or Qadr. Non-Sunni groups generally do not believe in Qadr. They don't believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wills the actions of the people, but rather they have ultimate free will. And Ahl Sunnah believes that Allah Azza wa Jal knows and also to a certain level wills as well. And therefore, there is the belief of Qadr. And there are other aspects of Sunni Islam. Now, this is generic Sunnism. By the way, one more thing we can say is that historically speaking, the Sunni community gathered around the legitimate Khalifa, whether it was the Umayyads or the Abbasids or the Ottomans. Ottomans or whoever their local governors were, even if they didn't like them, but they felt that the community is more important than breaking away and fighting against the caliph and whatnot. That's a legitimate khalifa, obviously, that used to exist in the past. Now, these are all things that combined mainstream, if you like, Sunnism. Now, obviously, as time developed within this strand, within this interpretation, various theologians came and the finer details or the more difficult questions were answered in diverse manners. And therefore, the question that I'm answering today, the two terms Salafi and Ash'ari. And to point out that both of these two terms are somewhat contested, in particular the term Salafism, that the term Salafism applies to a strand or a group that actually has multiple terms, whether you call it Athari, or you call it Hanbali theology, or the modern iteration is Salafism, that is one strand, and it is considered to be the one that is predominant in Saudi Arabia and in other places in the Muslim world. And the other strand we're talking about is Ash'arism, and that goes back to a particular individual by the name of Abu al-Hasan al-Ash'ari, who died around 320 Hijrah. And he was one of the first to develop a type of systematic theology that then paved the way for what we now call Ash'arism. And of course, in our times, we have very famous adherents to both of these strands. They go back very early in Islam. They have produced scholarship, they have produced ulama, they have produced works, they have produced institutions, and they are in some ways rival schools. In some ways, they are rivaling one another and they are competing for more adherence and refutations, which is what happens when you have anything of this nature. Now, how and why do they differ? And again, this is a very packed summary. Obviously, as usual, I give the caveat that so much more can be said. Time is always limited. For those who are completely, they're not aware of these differences, let me be very simplistic and summarize the differences in three primary ways or three primary notions. This is not exhaustive, it's just an introduction. First and foremost is the concept and the definition of iman. What exactly is iman? So the Ash'ari movement or the Ash'ari strand says that iman is tasdiq, which is affirmation of the heart or belief in the heart. So if you believe, then you are a Muslim and a mu'min. If you believe, then you have iman. Iman is that which is in the heart. It is to affirm with your heart, to know in your heart that Allah exists, the Prophet ﷺ is true, the Quran is the book of Allah. If you know it in your heart and you believe it in your heart, then this is iman. So they say iman is tasdiq. In contrast to this, the Athari school or the Salafi school says that iman is that which exists in the heart, is affirmed by the tongues, and is then practiced by the actions. And it goes up and it goes down. It increases and it decreases, right? Of course, the Ash'ari school believes that iman itself does not increase or decrease because they view iman, the analogy gives, like a light switch. Binary, either one or zero. You either have it or you don't. It's either up, the light is on, or down, the light is off. So from their perspective, iman is very much like a binary code. You either have it or you don't. You either know Allah is true and your creator and the Prophet is true, or you don't. There is no middle ground and there is no increase or decrease of actual iman. Whereas the Salafi school would say that iman, the actual term iman, consists of belief in the heart, statements of the tongue, and actions of the limbs, and it increases and it decreases. It increases if you do more good deeds, or you're in the spiritual state of mind, or you go for Hajj and Umrah, you're in the month of Ramadan, and it decreases when you're committing sins, when you're away from Allah Azza wa Jalla, when your heart has ghafla. And the actual term iman applies to actions as well. So actions, according to the Salafis, are an integral part of iman. It's not just a byproduct. It is within the term iman, and what we call iman, it comes within it. And of course, they therefore believe that actual iman increases and decreases, and therefore when Allah says in the Quran that iman goes up, وَيَزْدَادَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِيمَانًا فَزَادَتْهُمْ إِيمَانًا وَزَادَهُمْ تُقَى, that it's actually iman going increasing and decreasing. As for the Ash'ari school, they interpret these verses to mean that their iman is affirmed, not necessarily it increases. So this is one difference, the concept and definition of iman. Another difference between the Salafi and Ash'ari schools is the importance and the methodology of proving the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so the generally speaking, the Ash'ari school, their textbooks of theology, they follow a particular methodology of beginning with trying to prove the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then doing that in a very particular method. It is called in English the kalam cosmological argument. This is a very specific method of proving Allah's existence. If you study any course about proving God's existence, if you study any book, you will find 3 or 5 or 10 or 15 different methods that have been used historically to try to prove the existence of Allah or existence of God. And one of them, it is called the kalam or the cosmological proof, or the kalam cosmological proof. And this is a proof that its very origins, it goes back to Aristotle. You find reference of it actually even in Plato, you find a line or two. But Aristotle definitely has the rudimentary developments. But then early Muslim theologians from another school called Mu'tazilism, Abu al-Hudayl al-Allaf is one of the main people, they develop a very rudimentary methodology of proving Allah's existence. And this tactic or this methodology is then adopted by the Ash'ari school and then sanitized, and then it becomes a feature of that school. And again, very interesting way of doing that, beyond the scope of our particular Q&A here. But basically, I mean, to be very, very simplistic, it relies on the fact that the world around us consists of actual bodies. So this is a body, the table is a body, I'm a body, everything is a body. And that bodies, they have within them, subsisting within them, things that they call attributes or accidents. And accidents are that which subsists within a body. And so an accident would be color or temperature or size, X, Y, and Z coordinates. These are all accidents. By accidents, we don't mean like a car accident. By accidents, we mean that which subsists within a physical structure called a body. And so they have a very elaborate proof where they demonstrate that accidents must be created. And if accidents are created and accidents can only exist in bodies, then bodies must also be created. And therefore, if the body is created, there must be a creator who created the bodies. This is a very simplistic way of the kalam cosmological argument. And this is a backbone of Ash'ari theology. The existence of God is important to prove, and then how you prove it. In contrast to this, the Salafi movement, generally speaking, says that the existence of God is something that does not require elaborate proofs, and that it is something that is inherently ingrained in mankind, and that to deny this is to deny something that is self-evident. Hence, no matter how many proofs you try to give, it's somewhat of a waste of time. It's somewhat superfluous to try to prove the obvious. And so, generally speaking, the Salafi school does not prioritize philosophical proofs for the existence of God, believing that the existence of God is self-evident and does not require elaborate proofs. And then, in particular, they say this mechanism of proving God is something that is, from their perspective, problematic. And they say that this kalam cosmological argument, when it is employed, it actually leads to subsidiaries or corollaries that are problematic. And most importantly is how this proof affects the interpretation of Allah's names and attributes, which is point number 3 of our list. So point number 1 was the definition of iman. Point number 2 would be the importance of and how one proves the existence of God, the importance of proving, not the importance of, we all believe it's important to believe Allah exists, but the importance of proving that Allah exists. The Ash'ari school says the most important obligation is to prove Allah exists. And the Salafi school says the most important obligation is the worship of Allah. We assume, everybody should assume that Allah, that people know that Allah Azza wa Jalla exists. And then the third point of difference is the concept of Allah's attributes. And this is the most contentious. And this is what the schools are most famous for arguing about. This is really the area of controversy that any average, you know, internet user is aware of. Any average person who is involved with polemics, involved with, you know, online debates, involved with the various, you know, Muslim communities out there, they are well aware that this is the issue in which there's so much, you know, sometimes even online antagonism. How does one understand the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? When Allah azza wa jal says, وَيَبَقَى وَجْهُ رَبِّكَ, the face of your Lord shall remain. When Allah says in the Quran that I created Adam with both of my hands, خَلَقْتُ بِيَدَيَّ, When Allah says in the Quran, Ar-Rahmanu ala al-arshi istawa, the Rahman has risen over the throne. When Allah says in the Quran, وَجَاءَ رَبُّكَ وَالْمَلَكُ صَفًّا صَفًّا, your Lord will come on the day of judgment and the angels will come in rank upon rank. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, يَنزِلُ رَبُّنَا, our Lord comes down in the last third of the night. When Allah azza wa jalla says, يَخَافُونَ رَبَّهُم مِّن فَوْقِهِم, they fear their Lord who is above them. How does one understand all of these genre of attributes? As for the Salafi school, the Salafi school says that if Allah says it, Allah knows best how He is, and therefore we should simply affirm the word and not think about how. We don't think and we don't consider how. And so we leave the howness to Allah Azza wa Jal. That if Allah Azza wa Jal says He has a wajh, a face, so then we say He has a face. But we don't think about how it is. If Allah says He rises over the throne, so be it. This means He has a throne and He has risen over it. And we leave it at that. We don't think about how. This is called bal kafa or bila kaif. You negate the howness. So the Salafi school is famous as the only school in all of Islam that affirmed every single verb or adjective or noun ascribed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they said the word's meaning is understood, the word's howness is relegated to Allah. We don't think how it is. So this is the Salafi paradigm. As for the Ash'ari school, they said that we will only take seven of those attributes and affirm them with the Bila Kayf doctrine. So seven attributes, we will affirm them like the Salafis do, meaning that what I say like, not exactly like, but let me just say for the purposes of our Q&A, that they will affirm them without any kayf, without how. And these are life and knowledge and will and power and hearing and seeing and speech. These are the seven attributes that the Ash'ari say Allah has life, haya, and Allah has sama', and Allah has basar, and Allah has qudra, and Allah azza wa jal is sami' and basir, and Allah has a sifa of kalam and qudra. So all of these we shall affirm bila kayf. We're not going to think about how. However, all the other attributes we cannot affirm because that would imply that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a body. And so this goes back to our kalam cosmological argument. One of the attributes is that of motion. One of the attributes is that of motion. Something moves, this is an attribute. Motion does not exist by itself. There must be a body that caused that, you know, motion exists within. And so in order to prove point number two, which is how God exists, they have an elaborate proof, the kalam cosmological argument, and they prove that attributes are created, they prove that attributes must exist within bodies, and then they prove that bodies must be created. And one of the attributes is motion. Now, you come to the verse that your Lord has risen over the throne, and to rise is a type of motion. You come to the hadith, your Lord comes down, and that is a type of motion. You come to the verse in the Quran, وَجَاءَ رَبُّكَ, your Lord comes, and that is a type of motion. And so, the Ash'ari school says, clearly Allah did not intend these literal meanings. Because, they say, if you affirm those verbs, you are affirming the attribute of motion. And if you affirm the attribute of motion, this implies, a'udhu billah, that God is a body. And if God is a body, then a'udhu billah, all bodies are created. Again, go back to the kalam cosmological proof, right? Motion is an accident. Accidents must exist in bodies. Bodies are created. So if you ascribe to Allah istiwa and nuzul and maji, if you ascribe to Allah these concepts from the Ash'ari paradigm, you will logically conclude that whoever has that attribute must also be a'udhu billah created. And so from their paradigm, they say, no, we cannot affirm those types of attributes to Allah. And they also say the attributes of hand and face, this is anthropomorphic, it is human-like. And Allah says in the Quran, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ, there is nothing like Him. And so we say that all of this is metaphorical or symbolic, or they might say, all of this, our minds should go blank and we should not even think about the meaning of the word. Even the word, we just go blank. So when Allah says wajh or face, we don't even think of wajh, we just go blank. That's one way of doing this, it's called tafwid. Or the other way is to say that, well, by face Allah meant His blessings, His countenance. By rising over the throne, Allah meant His dominion has conquered the world. And so they, it's called ta'wir or reinterpretation. So the Ash'ari school has two positions, both of which are fine for them. Position A, you completely block out any meaning, any linguistic meaning. As for the Salafi school, remember, they will say, we'll affirm the linguistic meaning, but we will deny how it exists in Allah. We will say that Allah rises over the throne, but we won't think about how that occurs. And as for the Ash'ari school, they will say, no, clearly there is no actual throne, there is no actual rising over, and so it has to be negated. Then, either you have one of two options. Either you say, this whole phrase and passage, we simply go blank and don't think about it at all. Or it becomes metaphorical for Allah has power over the entire creation. Allah has risen over the throne. Allah has dominion over the entire creation. So these are some of the main differences. And of course, one of the more common questions that the Salafi Ash'ari debate has online is the famous debate, where is Allah? Where is Allah? And the Salafi says that the Quran and Sunnah indicate that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is above us. And there are hundreds of verses and ahadith that indicate what is called transcendence. Your Allah is above. يَخَافُونَ رَبَّهُمْ مِنْ فَوْقِهِمْ, that they fear their Lord who is above them. And the Prophet ﷺ asked the slave girl, where is Allah? And she said, Allah is above us. And so there's so many ahadith and ayat. And then to counter this, the Ash'ari school says, you clearly don't mean above in the three-dimensional sense, because what is above for one part of the world is below for the other part, and because three dimensions, and because all of this goes on and on and on. And by the way, this is a very brief intro. Every single point that I have said, the other group has a counterpoint, and the other group has a second counterpoint, the other group has a third counterpoint, ad infinitum. It goes on and on and on and on. These debates have occupied the minds of theologians for, no exaggeration, 12 if not 13 centuries. And so much has been written, you could spend many lifetimes, no exaggeration, going deep into these controversies and back and forth and back and forth. And so this is something that, and I would know because this is my area of expertise, and I have in fact spent not lifetimes, but many decades studying advanced issues of theology. So there's a lot to be said. We're summarizing here that these are some of the main differences between these two schools, the Salafi school and the Ash'ari school. And of course, these schools have famous scholars from the beginning of time. The Salafi school claims like Imam Ahmad. Of course, the most famous icon is Ibn Taymiyyah and Ibn al-Qayyim. And then the Ash'ari school has many famous ulama. Their most famous icon is Imam al-Ghazali, for example. So you have various, personalities that throughout history, they have manifested in both of these schools. And to compound the problem, to make it even more, complicated, that all that I described to you is actually early or classical Salafism and Ash'arism. Historically, a lot of other things happened because it's been around for 12 centuries, no exaggeration. 12 centuries, these two trends have existed side by side. At times, moments of tension, at times, moments of reconciliation. And so a lot has happened. And of the things that has happened, for reasons beyond the scope of our brief Q&A, is that the Salafi school has been associated with one particular madhab, the Hanbali madhab. And generally speaking, the Hanbali scholars were in some fashion or form within the spectrum of Salafism, or Atharism to be more precise, or Ahl al-Hadith it's also called. And the Maliki and the Shafi'i school, they gravitated towards Ash'arism. By the way, footnote here, so there's a third trend as well. So there's something called Maturidi or Maturidism as well. So we have Ash'arism, Salafism, and Maturidism. And Maturidis and Ash'aris are very, very close. The differences are even more abstract than what I've just done between Salafis and Ash'aris. For example, the Maturidis affirm 8 attributes instead of 7. So very, very small, very technical details between the Maturidi and the Ash'ari school. In reality, they even consider each other to be sister schools, and there's a very little difference between them. And the Maturidi school was basically co-opted by the Hanafi madhab. The Ottomans, they took the Hanafi school and the Maturidi school of theology, and they merged it together. And so historically, two of the madhabs became, because in the beginning they had, that's beyond the scope, but they became Ash'ari. One of them became Maturidi, and one of them, became Hanbali. Salafi. And so that's been the reality for the last so many centuries. And along with this, other changes came along, which further complicated the discussions between them, which did not exist in early the founding of these schools. And of them is, in particular, various understandings of tasawwuf, of how one practices Sufism, right? And this is another major controversy between all of these schools. So for example, to give you one simple example, and I'm not going to answer it here, but I'll just give it to you now. The Indian Pakistanis are aware of the Barelvi movement and the Deobandi movement. Both Barelvis and Deobandis are under the Maturidi Hanafi spectrum, right? So you see now that you have a mother school and that has two children and then they divide two. It's literally like a madrasa becomes more and more, and you have all of these splinters happening. We haven't even begun the political divisions now between political Islam, apolitical Islam, because that too plays a role in all of this type of interpretation. And then you have, of course, the understanding of tasawwuf and awliya, and the visitation of graves, and the veneration of graves, and the exaltation of saints, and the role of saints. All of this has permeated so that the differences are no longer just those three, even though technically those three and some others should be the only differences, but historically other differences were added. So for example, to celebrate the Mawlid or to not celebrate the Mawlid. This is a classic divide between modern Salafism and modern Ash'arism. This did not exist 1,000 years ago. That division did not exist over molded stuff, but this is something that is in the grand scale of things relatively more recent. In any case, I can go on and on and on, but you wanted a brief explanation, and this is a brief explanation. As I explained, that you have very many ulama from the Salafi school historically and in our times, and the University of Medina, which I graduated from, is associated with that strand of Islam as well, and it is predominant in Arabia, Saudi Arabia, and the scholars that have studied there and have been influenced by the revivalistic movement of that region. And Al-Azhar University, for example, is on the Ash'ari strand, and there are again many famous ulama historically and in our times as well. Now, these are some of the differences. Let us not forget, though, that the similarities between these two schools is actually far more than their differences, and especially when you compare them to other strands of Islam. In the end of the day, both of these schools believe in the six pillars of Iman as expressed in the Hadith of Jibreel. Both of these schools, they affirm the Quran and the Sunnah as the primary sources of theology and law. Both of these schools, they have the same ways of looking at fiqh and of deriving fiqh. In fact, they have the same books of fiqh and the same scholars of fiqh in University of Medina and in Al-Azhar. They study the same curriculums in terms of the books of fiqh, in terms of the books of hadith, in terms of the books of usul al-fiqh, in terms of the books of history, in terms of the books of language, in terms of the books of tafsir. In reality, the scholars of each movement are studied by the scholars of the other, even if there's some tensions at times, you know, between modern understandings. And that's something that needs to be stressed, is that what they share is far, far more than what they differ over. And historically, Salafis and Ash'aris have never divided themselves in different masajid or in completely different, you know, boycotting. I mean, unfortunately, sometimes you get calls to do that, but realistically, it's never happened. Alhamdulillah, thumma alhamdulillah, and we need to keep it that way. The tensions, even though they should not be there, have always been at an academic level. And my advice, as I conclude this question, my advice is that, you know, in both of these strands, you have scholars that are aiming to exacerbate the tension. They want to make it worse. They want to preach against the other and make the other into a deviant and show how evil the other side is, misguided. And you also have scholars that try to work together and find commonality. And the fact of the matter, whether, you know, whether people like me saying this or not is true, the average Muslim is completely in blissful unawareness of these differences between these two strands. In fact, the differences between them does not affect the lay Muslim at all. It doesn't really translate to their daily life in terms of these abstract issues of classical early Salafism and early Ash'arism. And currently, we are facing crises in every single arena of our life. Political, economic, you know, the nation state issues, the various invasions taking place, the crises of Syria and of Afghanistan and of Palestine. On top of this, we have crises of intellectual challenges, and people are, refuting aspects of our creed that we all agree upon. So rather than allow these tensions to increase, what we need to do is to work to minimize, in fact, to eradicate any tensions. Now, I am not saying that these differences are trivial. What I am saying is that we should not make a big deal out of them. And those who want to dedicate their lives to the study of Islam, at some point they will have to make a choice which textbooks they want to study and which groups of scholars they want to study for. I myself had to make the choice 25 years ago. I chose between Medina and Azhar, for example. I went the way that I did. I do not regret that. At some point you might have to make that choice, but if you make such a choice to study with one side, don't demonize the other side. Don't consider the other side to be, a'udhu billah, evil or misguided or going to Jahannam. A'udhu billah, there is iman and taqwa across all sides. And there's also nifaq and fisq on all sides as well. You have genuine piety and you have the opposite. So just because you study one version of Islam versus the other does not make you more pious. We have to be very clear about this. Piety transcends these human creeds and these differences between us. And you find righteous ulama and righteous ubad and awliya in both of these strands, and in fact in more than just these two strands. And we need to look at that as well. So what we have in common is far, far more important than what divides us. And therefore, we should not give platforms to preachers who exacerbate tensions between these movements. Rather, we should simply don't even pay them attention, because there are people like this, you know, on both sides, by the way. You have, you know, and I'll be honest here, 25 years ago, I myself was more sympathetic to that strand of harshness and considering them to be deviant, but that's young age. When I was 20 is different now. You know, wisdom and experience teaches you, seeing the realities of the ummah, it reorients your mind here. Subhanallah, these are people, both sides, there are people that are praying to the same God, following the same fiqh even, the same methodology to pray even, not even differences in fiqh and usul al-fiqh, they're pretty much the same in everything. It's just certain abstract notions that, you know, in any case. So my point being, you asked a question, this is the answer to it, I summarize the differences, and I say that Salafism and Ash'arism, and you can add Maturidism as well, they are two or three sister strands within mainstream Sunnism, and there are differences, and let the advanced students study those differences, but the average person should never, ever make those differences the defining characteristic of himself or of the other. And the laity of the ummah, really, alhamdulillah, there's no need for them to really get involved in these labels whatsoever, because it does not affect them in their daily lives. And alhamdulillah, thumma alhamdulillah, what unites these two strands is so much more that really we can say that for practical purposes, the differences are really trivial. And that's the way that we should look at these two strands. And in the end, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. Our next question is from sister or brother Sajrat. I don't know if it's a sister or brother, I apologize. Sajrat from Kashmir. And the question is about Sufism. And the question is that some people accept it and follow it, whereas others criticize it. And so I am asked by this sister or this brother, can I shed some light on this issue? So, just like our previous question, this is a theological one. And again, as I said today, I'm going to be doing theological questions. And so, I'm being asked about Sufism. And again, so much can be said and time is limited. The term Sufism or Sufi, most likely it comes from the term wool, Suf in Arabic, Suf. And that's because the earliest practitioners of Tasawwuf would dress in wool because it was the cheapest and the coarsest material, and that automatically gives you an understanding of who the early mutasawwifa or Sufis were. They were people who wanted to live simplistic, ascetic lives, not involved in the luxuries of this world. Now, there's a lot to be said about Sufism, but one could say that the main thrust of Sufism is that they view the world in a very different manner. They view that the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only real existence, and that the human soul is somehow linked with, maybe even connected to, or an emanation of the essence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that the goal is to have that human soul somehow reunited, either in the proximity or maybe even, you know, with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The goal is then for the human soul to then, you know, go back to its origin, because the origin is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to be reunited with Allah. And that goal is being hampered by this world around us, by the body that we are in, by the lusts and the pleasures of this world. And therefore, what needs to be done, which is what Tasawwuf does, is that we need to break all of our connections with our bodily desires, our ta'alluq with other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with extrinsic objects, and we need to allow our spirit to pass through this world with as little attachments as possible, so that when death happens, so that the soul will then with ease move on to its divine destiny, its origin, and that is the oneness with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's a very simplistic way of looking at tasawwuf. And early Sufis, they were generally speaking people who renounced this world. People like Ibrahim ibn Adham, Rabi' al-Adawiyya, that they live very simplistic and ascetic lives. There's even a contempt for the world. You just don't want to do anything with it. There's a sense of antagonism towards the richness of this world, towards good food and good wine. You don't want any of that. You don't want to corrupt the body, because the notion, there's a tension between the body and the soul. And if you obey the body, you're going to corrupt the soul. So this notion of tension between the body and the soul is a very Sufi concept. And this notion of not adhering to or not allowing bodily desires to be given any type of weight or priority. The less priority given, it is the better for mankind. And it is possible to divide Sufism, again, very simplistically, I'm being very simplistic here. One can divide Sufism into two primary strands. Again, you can divide it into many, but for our purposes, we'll say two primary strands. And this goes back to very early tasawwuf. You have a strand that I will call philosophical Sufism. The more technical term is monism. Some have called it, there's many terms to be called it, but let's just call it philosophical Sufism. And by this, I mean a strand of Sufism that understands, that claims that there is no existence other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that we don't actually exist. It's not a denial of the pleasures of man, it's a denial of the reality of man. It is the claim that in reality our bodies are not really there, and that there is nothing in existence other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the technical term for this is monism. Later on it is called wahdatul wujud, that there's one existence. And people like in early Islam, Bayezid, Abu Yazid al-Bastami, and others like Al-Hallaj, and others like Ibn Arabi, they followed this strand. And there's a very heavy emphasis on the negation of the illusion of any existence other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there's some really interesting or bizarre phrases, like Al-Hallaj would say, I am Al-Haq, I am Allah Azza wa Jal. And he would say that there's nothing in my thobe other than He, other than Allah. So these phrases were interpreted as basically blasphemy by everybody else, because they are not on the same wavelength, and frankly that wavelength is not coming from the Quran and Sunnah. But anyway, they interpreted these phrases to be completely, you know, blasphemy. And some of these, like Al-Hallaj, were even executed for what they considered to be blasphemy. So that is one strand of Sufism, and frankly, I'm not a big fan of that strand, and I do believe that that strand has exceeded the spectrum of tolerance. Let me put it that way. They have gone beyond what we can theologically tolerate, and that we should say that that interpretation of life and of existence really does not stem from the Quran and Sunnah. And understandably, when people go around claiming that, you know, there's nothing in my thobe other than Allah or this and that, then understandably the average Muslim community is very perturbed and finds it problematic, and that should not be done. So I'm not, you know, too sympathetic to that strand. The other strand of Islam, of Sufism, let's call it experiential Sufism. The emphasis on this strand was to train the soul. It wasn't to deny the existence of other than Allah. That's correct. Because the first strand denies that anything exists other than Allah. So, La ilaha illallah for the first strand becomes La wujuda or La mawjuda illallah. That's how they interpret the kalima. That there is no existence other than the existence of Allah. So we don't really exist or nothing really. This is all an illusion. What we see around us, you can knock, but it's an illusion. It's not really there. That's the first strand. Frankly, that, to be technical, that goes back to something called Gnosticism, but that's beyond the scope of our Q&A here. But so, the second strand, which is something we can actually deal with a little bit more, let's call it experiential Sufism. The emphasis here is not on the philosophy of monism, it is on the training of the soul. And it is on their version of maintaining a purity in this world until the time of death. And we have a lot of early Sufis that were on this path, people like Al-Junaid, people like Al-Muhasibi. These are people that clearly their understanding of tasawwuf is very different than that of Hallaj. And we have to be careful that sometimes the critics of tasawwuf, they mix and match between all of these strands. One of the biggest problems is Sufism is not one interpretation. Sufism is like a huge spectrum, and you cannot criticize one aspect of the spectrum and then say all of Sufism does this. This is frankly a slander against the entire notion of Sufism. If you take one strand or one extremist person and then say all Sufis, that's just wrong, and it's un-Islamic, and it's unethical, and it's unacademic. We don't do this. Unfortunately, all too often, one finds some of the critics of tasawwuf do this. They find a video clip of somebody, you know, so that strand, for example, is also very mystical in terms of its outward, so going round and round, let's say, right, the whirling dervishes. And again, that's the oneness. They're going round and round till they lose themselves. The purpose, by the way, of the whirling dervishes is actually an actual sect of the Sufis or a tariqah of the Sufis. The goal is to lose yourself, literally. The goal is to just, you keep on twirling for so many hours, obviously your mind ceases to function normally. You think you're in a state of ecstasy. That's what they're trying to achieve here, right? Or you might find other manifestations of, extreme movements that we call dancing, but they would not call dancing. Extreme movements where the notion is they've lost rationality because they've achieved that union they're looking for with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Somebody sends you a WhatsApp clip or it's on YouTube and say, oh look, that's what Sufism is. No, please, brothers and sisters, stop doing this. Stop extrapolating from one video clip about the entire movement. Would you like it if the far right takes one clip from some extremist Muslim and then says, all Muslims do this? We don't like it. Then why then do you do it when you criticize another sect or another interpretation? You can say this group of Sufism, that's what they do. You better be accurate. Maybe one group does it. Okay, you can say this particular tariqah or this particular person encourages this action. Okay, that's fair. But to then extrapolate all of tasawwuf, this is just a slander. Wallahi, it is a slander. The majority of the people of tasawwuf do not move in radical manners. They do not go whirling round and round. They do not, they don't do these types of things that are unfortunate. Some Muslims make fun of. This is a small, small group. And we say that's not mainstream tasawwuf, nor is it mainstream Islam. So the point being that the second strand of Sufism, which is what I call experiential Sufism, what they want to do is they want to train the soul on the journey to Allah. They say that there is a path or a tariq to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they want to encourage people to understand that there is a path. You have to know there's the path, and you have to want to join the people on the path, so you become the seeker or the salik. You want to be joined the movement. You want to get onto board so that you know there's the movement. And then the seeker or the salik is then taught about various stations of the path. These are called maqam or manazil. So these are stations that you have to go to this station, then this station. These are not actual paths. This is the state of the mind here. And then you have, when you reach certain stations, you will experience certain spiritual ecstasies called ahwal. And at every stage and at every point, you then go to a different level. And eventually, if you follow the path properly, so then you will achieve, the highest level, and your soul will basically have achieved that sense of union, the sense of union. Now, whether you actually achieve union or not depends on which strand of tasawwuf you are following. But the claim is that when you achieve that actual, sense of union, then the illusion of this world has been lifted from you, and that's called kashf. The kashf is the lifting of the veil. And you have achieved oneness with Allah, which is fana, which is fana. So your soul has now been reunited with its origin, with its maker. And this is called the concept of the fana. Now, and again, how it's interpreted varies from strand to strand. So the point being, as I said, that you have from the very beginning two strands of Sufism. We are more interested in the experiential one because that's something we can actually relate to. And experiential tasawwuf, they view themselves as being the manifestation of the third category of the hadith of Jibreel, Islam, Iman, Ihsan. That group says we are the Ihsan status. That's what Ihsan is. And their critics would argue, well, that's your interpretation of Ihsan, and we have our interpretation of Ihsan. So they say that Ihsan is what deals with the heart, and Iman and Islam deals with the body and the tongue. That's the outer rituals. And Ihsan is the science of the qalb. And Islam and Iman is the science of the brain and of the body. So they have this understanding there as well. And now the question arises, how does one walk on this path? How does one achieve that success to get to the end of the path? So generally speaking, mainstream tasawwuf says you cannot walk alone. You need a guide. The path is too complicated and it's just very difficult. You don't wander into a forest all on your own. You take a guide. And so they say you have to find, they call him a wali or a buzurg or a peer who has already done all of this for you. And you then, you know, in most strands of tasawwuf, you make an alliance or a treaty or a bay'ah or a covenant or an oath with this buzurg or this peer. And the point is that the goal is that this person is going to take you along the path and help you to go from station to station to station until finally, you know, if you do your job properly, you know, you don't need him anymore and you're now achieved at that station. And there's also this notion that there is an inner knowledge, al-ilm al-laduni or al-ilm al-batini, that is not found in the books, but it is found in the experiences of your teachers, in the mystical understandings of the awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so the need of a sheikh or the buzurg is that you cannot learn what the buzurg will teach you except in the company, except from heart to heart and not from a book. The knowledge of tasawwuf, according to them, is not found in a book. You cannot study it. You cannot have a PhD in tasawwuf from their perspective. You need to experience that tasawwuf with the sheikh, with the peer who has already arrived over there. And that's a version of what is called tariqa Sufism. As well, tasawwuf is known for various rituals that we, even non-Sufis practice, but then they take it to their own understanding. Most importantly, how they do dhikr and the repetition of their dhikr and the repetition of the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These are well-known practices of various Sufi groups. So maybe to repeat a certain dhikr 99 times, or, you know, repeat a surah, you know, 11 times, or to have a wird, what is called a wazifa. You know, you have a wazifa that you go every time at Fajr, you do this, at Maghrib, you do that, and you have a different wazifa or wazifa. And then when you do this for a few months, your buzurg or your teacher will then say, you've passed stage one, now move on to stage two, and you're given another. Then stage three, you're given another. And it goes on and on and on. So all of these are associated with various Sufi understandings. As well, some manifestations or strands of Sufism, some, not all, are also interested or take to devotional poetry and poetry that is accompanied by musical instruments as well. And most famously in India and Pakistan is you have, of course, the Qawwali movements or the Qawwali manifestations of various Sufi, because Qawwali, by the way, its origin is actually Sufi devotional poetry, right? So it's a very Sufi manifestation, and of course this is known to all Indian, Pakistanis, Bengalis. They understand, they know what is Qawwali. It is a part of Indian culture for sure, but what I'm trying to say is not a cultural thing as much as it is a religious. It is actually a manifestation of a type of what is called sama' or a ritual ceremony, which is meant to be rewarded by Allah, and it is meant to help guide you in your path, in your journey to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And of course, even that is subject, because other Sufis will disagree and say that should not be done. So anyway, there's a lot to be said, trying to summarize so much into one, you know, brief Q&A. Do realize, by the way, that giving bay'ah to a sheikh and following what is called tariqah is not necessary to be a Sufi, because one can also categorize Sufism into two, tariqah versus non-tariqah. Tariqah Sufism, it has a specific hierarchy, and you give bay'ah to a particular sheikh. So you have the Suhrawardi, you have the Chishti, you have the Shadhili, right? You have the Tijani, you have the Qadiri tariqah. These are tariqah Sufism. These are well-known hierarchy. And you will then find the sheikh, and you will give bay'ah to the sheikh. The sheikh will then assess you. You will follow that sheikh. He will guide you along. Maybe even you will not undertake any life decision without asking the sheikh. So there's a very trusting position that you have. Unfortunately, we also know of times that has been abused. Whenever you trust a person, if the person turns out to be a crook, then you know that's the reality as well. But anyway, we should not throw out. I mean, from their perspective, they will say this happens with any organization. Just because some bad apples exist doesn't mean the entire, you know, barrel is bad. But that is tariqah Sufism. There's also non-tariqah Sufism, which is becoming very popular in our times. I would say that historically it wasn't as popular 200, 300, 500 years ago, but non-tariqah Sufism is basically, let me just read the books of the people of Tasawwuf, like Imam al-Ghazali in his famous Ihya Ulumuddin, which is a very mainstream Sufi text. It's not radical Sufi, it's like a very mainstream Sufi text, which goes over many of the primary issues of Tasawwuf. So they might read this and then bring it in their daily lives. Now, again, much can be said. And by the way, there have also been attempts, especially in the last 200 years, to reform or to revive or to reject Sufism. The most famous rejection of Sufism was by the movement of Ibn Abdul Wahhab in Arabia, the Najdi Ibn Abdul Wahhab movement. They rejected Sufism, the most harsh rejection in the last, you know, millennia, to be honest. No group has been more anti-tasawwuf than this movement. And they even consider some of the practices of tasawwuf to be, well, most of the practices of tasawwuf they consider bid'ah. Some of them they even consider shirk, such as, you know, veneration of the saints to an extreme level. So this is like the attempt to reject Sufism. You've had attempts to revive Sufism, and the most famous is the Bareilvi movement of India and Pakistan to revive that. They want to now go back and basically bring back the revival of Tasawwuf. And then there have also been attempts to reform from within, right? So you have the rejection, the revival, then the reformation from within. For example, Shah Waliullah Dihlavi is perhaps one of the most famous to try to reform, to sanitize, to cut off some of the excesses. And perhaps one can say, I'm being a little bit simplistic here, but I think it is fair to say that the Deobandi movement is basically following the spirit of Shah Waliullah in this regard, where they want to produce a somber, an orthodox version of Tasawwuf from their perspective. And again, all of this is relative to which paradigm you are sympathetic to. Now, the sister or the brother asked about what is, you know, what is to be done, or what is the correct or what not. And the response is, I mean, it depends on who you ask, obviously. You want my advice, you're asking me, you emailed me. And by the way, subhanAllah, I'm very touched that I get so many emails from Kashmir, and my du'as go to the people of Kashmir for all of their struggles. And I have to say that I am very pleasantly surprised by the many, many emails I get from the province of Kashmir. They watch on YouTube, and some of them say that we have internet problems, but we try to, whenever there's internet, you know, we try to watch your videos, and then, you know, we're not able to watch because the government pulls it away from us. And Allah, it's just to know that they're in so much struggle and pain, and the occupation and the clamp down and the pellet bullets that have blinded hundreds or tens of thousands, and the riots. I mean, wallahi, you are in our du'as, O people of Kashmir, and it really touches me that so many emails come from that province. And you know, this one as well, very eager to learn the religion. Obviously, I'm summarizing what he or she has written. So you wanting my advice about this issue, and I will say that firstly, as a lay Muslim, stick with your ulama and don't get involved in the business of refutations and debates. You can disagree with other groups without being disagreeable. What I mean by this, you can disagree and still smile and shake their hands and be fellow Muslims, right? You don't have to agree on everything. You follow what you think is the best. You follow your group. You follow your sheikh that you really feel is the most pure and the most knowledgeable and the closest to the Quran and Sunnah, and leave the rest if you're a lay Muslim. Also, be very careful and never ever follow those groups of ulama or people that are promoting hatred of other people who bow their head to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There are ulama and preachers in every sect whose primary focus is the other sect. Their primary antagonism is towards others who say the kalima, face the qibla, memorize the Quran, lower their head to Allah, but they disagree about a certain issue. My advice to you, avoid hate preachers. Avoid preachers who are preaching sectarianism, whose every second, third statement is a refutation of that group and that group and that group and that group. Subhanallah, you will not build your iman by destroying the iman of others in your eyes. That's not how you build your iman. Do not follow preachers whose emphasis by their preaching is the negation of other understandings of Islam. Yes, sometimes certain understandings need to be refuted, but that should not be the priority. The priority is you build your own iman. The priority is you worship Allah yourself. You have your own salah, your own zakah, your own rituals, your own Quran. Any sheikh that emphasizes this and once in a while corrects others, that's a good sign. That's a good sign. But any sheikh whose main preaching and teaching is to cause you to hate other Muslims and other people and whatnot, that's not the religion of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now also I want to say that, you know, you are writing to me from the province of Kashmir. Surely, dear brother or dear sister, you understand the importance of unity. You understand that it makes no sense for the Muslim community that is already under siege, literally under siege for the last 70 years and under army siege and military siege for the last 20 or 30 years. It makes no sense for the Salafi and the Deobandi and the Barelvi and the Ahli Hadith and the Jamaati, all of them to be fighting each other. You clearly have an outside enemy. Literally, you see them. So subhanAllah, do not preach hatred amongst yourselves and learn to agree to disagree. I'm not saying all of these differences are trivial. I never said this. I'm not saying we should ignore. I'm saying we have to learn to agree to disagree. Say, you know what? I have my way of doing Islam. You know, I know you're sincere. You have your way. Allah will judge us. And I mean, you know, and if you want to have a pleasant conversation, if you have knowledge and you know the evidences and you want to have a pleasant conversation, no hatred, no animosity, but explain, you know, this is what I believe, this is why I believe it. The Quran says this, the Sunnah says that. What is your evidence? If you're able to have a pleasant conversation without hating somebody else, then go for it. If you have the knowledge and you have the adab and the taqwa to do so. Otherwise, dear brother or dear sister, for really, just it's not worth our time to make this such a big issue. Tasawwuf is a very broad term. With this I conclude. Tasawwuf is a very broad term. It is impossible to praise or to criticize all of tasawwuf. Listen to this carefully. Anybody who generically praises all of tasawwuf or criticizes all of tasawwuf, frankly, I'm trying to be nice here, they don't know what they're talking about. You cannot. Tasawwuf is too broad. And you have to get down to the specifics and nitty-gritty. There are aspects of tasawwuf that are pure 100% upon the sunnah. The adhkar after fajr. Who says you should not do that? Go and find out what the Prophet ﷺ said and sit there after fajr. Tahajjud, long tahajjud. That is real tasawwuf. Reading Quran in the middle of the night, that is the essence of tasawwuf. Muraqabatul qalb, always looking at your heart, that is tasawwuf. Dhikr, your tongue should always be doing dhikr, that is tasawwuf, right? Inaba, tawbah, khushu', tawakkul, all of this is tasawwuf. This is the reality of tasawwuf. So if that is tasawwuf, then we should all be upon the people of tasawwuf. And then there are other things that definitely raise your eyebrows. To have a specific wazifa, you know, we're getting into a gray area, and I can understand some people think it's permissible, some people think it's not. You know, to recite Surah Al-Ikhlas 11 times at 9 a.m., for example, I mean, you know, I see why they're doing it, and I personally don't want to do that. I'm not going to make a big deal about this, and I respectfully disagree, but that's what they do, and that's their version of dhikr, and I think that, you know, that I don't personally find that what I want to do myself. I want to follow what the Prophet ﷺ did as much as possible. That's my personal way of doing things. From their perspective, they're saying, what's wrong with reciting Surah Al-Ikhlas 11 times? It worked for my sheikh, it should work for me. And I see their perspective, I respectfully disagree. And then there's a red line, and that red line is to believe that Allah is within us or to stop following the sharia. There is no tasawwuf without the sharia. Any group that tells you you don't have to follow the sharia, forget tasawwuf, they're not Muslims. I'm just being blunt here. Any group that says you don't have to follow the sharia, you have now reached a state, and there are very small fringe movements like this. And then again, I mean, I have to draw the line somewhere. I personally really do not find it comfortable when you go to the point of venerating another being, to the point of asking that being for your needs, to the point of calling out to that being for what you want, really I have to draw the line there, and I say that that is not something that should be done. It is dangerous. You're opening up the door that is very, very dangerous. When you're going to call the awliya for your daily needs, for forgiveness, a'udhu billah, this is not, I mean, I can understand the argument that it is shirk, and I can understand the argument that it is a haram and stepping stone to shirk. Both of these arguments have validity to them, but definitely they are not sunnah, and definitely this is wrong. So if you have groups that are telling you to make dua or call out to the awliya for your needs, if you have groups that tell you to bow down and do sajda to a grave, we have to draw the line and say, no. This is not any type of tasawwuf that we can tolerate. There is tasawwuf that I can tolerate. There is tasawwuf that we can agree to disagree. And you have your way and I have my way. Generally speaking, mainstream Ghazali and tasawwuf, you read Ihya Ulumuddin, you follow what is in there, or even mainstream tariqah tasawwuf, you follow the mainstream of the Shadiri or the Qadiri tariqah or whatnot, and they're telling you to do your adhkar and Quran and whatnot. I understand. And inshallah, there's piety, there's iman. I personally don't, you know, that's not the way I have been trained and taught in my experiences, and I have never felt the need to go down that route, but I can see other people have had different experiences, and I don't view them as being, a'udhu billah, evil people if they choose that path. But we have to have lines. And inshallah ta'ala, I hope we can all agree that of the lines that we should not do is to invoke other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or to prostrate to any type of object that is, you know, other than Allah azza wa jal, you know, or to, you know, to do these types of movements that demean the dignity of our faith, you know, which some of the movements do, the twirling, the motions of jumping up and down, becoming ecstatic, you know, or these are things that I find very problematic, and I just can't be quiet, and they need to be said that, you know, this is not what the Prophet ﷺ did or the Sahaba did, and we should keep our religion dignified. Nonetheless, when all is said and done, there are elements of tasawwuf that are very good and pure, such as dhikr and muraqab and all of these things. And so if a person takes these concepts and reads about them in the Quran and in the Sunnah, and by the way, one of the best books is Riyadh al-Salihin, in my opinion. Riyadh al-Salihin, go read this book by Imam al-Nawawi. It's in every single language of the Muslim world. And read the chapters about the qalb and this, and let's read all of these chapters and then follow that. And if you ask me, that is real tasawwuf, and that is the reality of ihsan. And if you do this, then you have maintained safety and purity, and you have followed the tasawwuf of the Tazkiyat al-Qur'an, the following of the Qur'an and the Sunnah. And with this, inshaAllah ta'ala, we come to the conclusion of today's Q&A. Until next week, Jazakumullah khair. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
وَاذْكُرُوا اللَّهَ فِي أَيَّامٍ مَعْدُودَاتٍ فَمَنْ تَعَجَّلَ فِي يَوْمَيْنِ فَلَا إِثْمَ عَلَيْهِ وَمَنْ تَأَخَّرَ فَلَا إِثْمَ عَلَيْهِ لِمَنِ اتَّقَى وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَاعْلَمُوا أَنَّكُمْ إِلَيْهِ تُحْشَرُونَ